Michael Patrick Shields is on the air.
Good morning, world.
Good morning, Michigan. A very pleasant Tuesday to you. It's Michael Patrick Shields, heard all across the state of Michigan. And standing before a nation clamoring for jobs, President Barack Obama will call for targeted spending to boost the economy, but also for budget cutting in tonight's State of the Union address, his first in the new era of divided political power. Television audience will be in the tens of millions. Obama will hone in on jobs, the issue of the most importance to the public, and for his hopes for a second term. War and other concerns bid for attention, but the president has chosen to lean heavily on the economy with far less emphasis on foreign affairs. That's what you can expect in tonight's State of the Union address, and we will have analysis of that tomorrow morning. 7 minutes, make it eight now after the hour. The news now that former Governor Jennifer Granholm is going to be teaching at the University of California, Berkeley, and will be a paid contributor to NBC's Meet the Press. Now, her husband, Dan Mulhern, who will join us in just a few minutes, said on his website that they're going to move to California, and the former governor is also going to write a book about her experiences leading the state during the recession. Governor Granholm is leaving Michigan. They are searching to buy a lake home in Michigan to use as their home base, but they will both teach at UC Berkeley through the 2013 academic year. Granholm is going to teach classes on energy, governing through tough economic times, and industrial policy, and will be on Meet the Press as well. David Gregory, the host of Meet the Press for NBC, will join us on the very first day that Governor Granholm contributes to that show. The anchorman, Gary Austin, is with us. Is this a surprise to you, Gary, that Governor Granholm and her husband are leaving the state?
Well, you know, Michael Patrick, she had been weighing her options, and, you know, I had some tell me that she was seriously considering exploring the possibility of becoming a judge in Michigan. At what level, we don't know. Perhaps Supreme Court, perhaps at the appellate level. But somewhere in the judiciary is where some had suggested Governor Granholm would likely end up once she left the job as the state's, you know, governor. But, yeah, I think it is somewhat surprising her leaving the state. I mean, UC Berkeley, I can only imagine with her political experience and what have you, she will fit in there just fine, as will husband Dan. It'll be curious to hear Dan Mulhern's assessment of all this when you talk with him about this big move for this for our former first couple in Michigan here before long.
We will talk to Dan Mulhern about that in just a couple of minutes. Have you ever heard of Sierra Sanchez?
You know, not until this morning. Boy, old Sierra Sanchez, you know, I guess a porn star, and now has something else to add to her resume.
Yeah, she has pled guilty to her role in a prostitution service in Detroit. She's 24 years old, and she enticed a person to take part in prostitution as well, and she was running the overseas call centers for Miami Companions Escort Services, and she made porn movies in California, 18 months in prison, perhaps, and there are sentencing guidelines about that, but she may be sentenced to as many as 20 years in April. That's a big penalty,
boy,
isn't
you know, it sure is, and this story actually broke months ago, and there was some concern. State officials were actually haggling about this as to how to go about the overall investigation when it came to
the black book.
Releasing information. Yeah, the old black book and all those potential names of clients of these alleged prostitutes.
Clients, so, customers,
well, yeah.
Johns, if you will.
Whatever you want to call it. And this story is just the beginning, I think. This is just starting to unravel now. Now we're hearing names and whether or not you know, Joe and Jane on Main Street, someone, perhaps you, maybe your next-door neighbor, who knows? You never know. I mean, who could be in that black book? And, you know, and there are a lot of folks who are saying it's a privacy concern, and we have this. It's turned into a legal battle now, but, you know, the feds are saying the only way you can really get this thing out in the open is to put it out in the open. So we'll see.
You know, there's Mayor Virge Bonero here in the city of Lansing had his State of the City address last night, and he's got to resolve a $15 million budget shortfall. But he did so at the Knapps building, the historic Knapps building, where there's lots of renovation going on. And his theme was, it's happening in Lansing. And he talked about a lot of the projects that are changing the city's face, like General Motors has a new production line for the Grand River plant. there is that $36.4 million renovation of the Knapp's store that we're talking about. And, of course, the national headquarters of the Accident Fund at the Ottawa Street Power Station. So he says he's retooling Lansing as a destination, a magnet for people of all ages, and the infrastructure and the parks and all the rest of it. So we appreciate the efforts of the man who ran for governor and now is back in office as the mayor of the city of Lansing. And in Grand Rapids, Gary, they're also having a little bit of a debate about exactly what sort of people to draw to the city of Grand Rapids and what sort of event, because there is apparently something called the River City Bike Week that some organizers want to have in the first week in July. It's one of those events where, you know, maybe 100,000 motorcycle riders would come into town on their bikes, and they're going to have musical acts, ZZ Top, Steve Miller, and the Doobie Brothers. And they're talking about 100,000 motorcycle riders coming into downtown Grand Rapids. You know, they do these events in Sturgis, and Muskegon has one too, doesn't it? And also at Daytona Beach, they have two times a year, Bike Week or Biketoberfest or whatever it might be. But even though it could bring $22 million to the economy, there are some owners, business owners, who don't like the idea of a bike rally. They don't think it fits downtown. They think it would be noisy and the crowds would be big concerns, and that could cause the Grand Rapids City Commissioners to reject the event. We're going to talk with Mayor George Hartwell a little bit later. He said he's been having lots of negative response, emails, calls, that sort of thing. And so, you know, maybe they'll move it out to Millennium Park. Maybe they won't have it. But we'll talk about that question.
Yeah, I don't know how in the world you could regulate something like that. I mean, if the group goes through all the
procedures.
Well,
you've got to have permits for festivals and things like that.
But yeah, I mean, if they go through all, I mean, obviously, but they get the permit situation all squared. I mean, who's to say? I mean, just because some folks say, hey, those motorcycles are too noisy, we don't want them down Main Street here in Grand Rapids. I mean, it's a tough call in the city, and certainly Mayor Hartwell, they're a big input on the final say of this. But I would think if this group does everything it's supposed to do and goes through all the legal hoops and everything's all in order, and then the city says, no, you can't do it because motorcycles are too noisy or dirty or whatever the case may be, or, you know, too many people all packed into one area, whatever the complaint is, you know, I think you're just opening yourself wide open for potential legal action. You know, the situation with Lansing Mayor Bernero and his State of the City talk last night. It was really neat where he did that, as you mentioned, in the old Knapp's department store. And if, for those who don't know downtown Lansing, that was a real hub. I mean, that's where everybody went back in the 30s, 40s, and 50s when Knapp's was really thriving. I mean, of course, the place is closed, been closed for years, but it's been reopened, and now the building is used for other things. But it was curious to hear, for example, state lawmaker Joan Bauer. She was one of those at the mayor's talk last night, and she was saying that, you know, I used to work here up on the second floor. You know, I sold china, you know, in this very building. So you talk about a renovation project that really has a linkage from those who are you know, still around today, who can remember what it used to be like and how the building sat vacant for so long and who knew what was going to happen to it. And now we see all of these renovation projects. And certainly Mayor Bernero has gone out of his way to hang his hat on that sort of thing, and he's been very good at it here.
Yep, and now also in sort of an urban development kind of story, the ridership and revenue are up on the Amtrak Pierre Marquette line, according to MDOT. Also, a large increase on the Wolverine route. That goes from Pontiac and Detroit to Chicago, and also the Blue Water route. Lots of people are taking the train these days, it seems, from Amtrak, and that Pierre Marquette line goes from Grand Rapids to Chicago, makes stops in Holland and St. Joseph along the way, funded by the state, but gaining in popularity. Lots of people taking a trip on a train.
Yep, sure is. Amtrak is back, as they say, and a lot of talk, too. It'll be curious to see how the late state legislature picks up where the old state legislature left off on that whole issue of that high-speed rail line, you know, hooking up all various parts of the state. We'll see how that goes. Whether or not the state has the money for that sort of thing, I know there have been certain options the state has been looking at. For example, perhaps rounding up some federal money to help out with the project. President Obama has expressed an interest in this, saying that the feds may be able to chip in some, but you know, we can see how that goes here. We do have another note to pass along. That serial rapist in Detroit, now he has been arraigned and identified, 31-year-old Renard Coleman, and apparently some of those women who were allegedly sexually assaulted mm-hmm. in this case. Several have identified a suspect now as they went through the lineup and they go through all that business. So in any event, a preliminary hearing has been set for the 4th of next month for him.
All right. And GM is adding a third shift at the Flint Assembly Plant. That's going to add 750 jobs.
Yep.
They build the Chevy Silverado there and the GMC heavy-duty pickups. And it's going to start in the third quarter of this year. And so that's good news.
You betcha.
For the Flint area, which can use good news, right?
Love to hear that. Anytime we can add jobs, especially in the auto industry, we'll take them.
There are repairs planned today on a 50-foot speed bump on M44 in Kent County. It's been freezing and thawing, and it's caused a reverse pothole. Maybe you've run into it near the Kent-Ionia County line. So the highway is going to be closed from 8 in the morning till 5 so they can dig out and repair that reverse pothole. 18 minutes after the hour, First Gentleman Dan Mulhern on his way out of town. Coming next, it's Michael Patrick Shields. And we never let the birthday of a beautiful woman pass without taking note. Alicia Keys, you're hearing in the background here, Grammy winner, is 30. Happy birthday, darling, to you. It's good stuff, isn't it? Another fantastic singer, Christina Aguilera, is going to the Super Bowl. The NFL has announced that that Grammy winner is going to sing the national anthem at this year's showdown between the Pittsburgh Steelers and the Green Bay Packers in Dallas. She says it's a dream come true, and she has had lots of practice performing the national anthem, having done so since she was 7 years old. And isn't that terrific? And she's from Pittsburgh originally, if I'm not mistaken, and so she'll be rooting for the Steelers, too, there. We're going to have, Black Eyed Peas will serve up the halftime entertainment at the show, and that will be on Fox on February 6th. It's the most-watched event on U.S. television and a broadcast haven for advertisers. 153 million people watched the Super Bowl last year, and the other thing that people like to watch are the Academy Awards. This morning, the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences is setting the stage for film's biggest night. Nominations for the 83rd Annual Academy Awards will be announced at a press conference this morning at 8:30. And the Oscar-winning actress Monique is going to join the Academy President Tom Chirac, and they will announce 10 of the award's 24 categories at the Goldwyn Theater there in Beverly Hills. The 83rd Annual Academy Awards will be presented on February 27th. That's a Sunday at the Kodak Theater, and ABC will carry that live. So this morning, we'll have the nominees live on our air, so you can hear Hollywood. The day Hollywood wakes up early, because if it's 8:30 Eastern, it's 5:30 in the morning there. So the stars are all curious to see, are they nominated? And we know that perhaps Natalie Portman will be nominated for Best Actress. We know that perhaps The King's Speech and Black Swan, maybe The Social Network and some of the other films will be nominated for Best Picture. So we'll have that live for you, live audio as it happens from Hollywood at about 8:30 this morning. The 400 people are not going to be happy in April because JCPenney is going to close its catalog call center in Kentwood. It's a restructuring plan that includes more emphasis on internet sales and less on catalog business. So five call centers will be consolidated into three locations in Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Wisconsin. The final business affected by that gas leak in Wayland reopens today, Hastings City Bank. Has been operating out of City Hall since the gas leak last week. The bank and the flower shop remain closed after gas trapped in the frozen ground seeped into the buildings. Wayland Floral and Gift reopened on Monday, but I know we have listeners in Hastings on WBCH, and they should want to know that the Hastings City Bank, which has been operating out of City Hall, is going to reopen this morning. It's 26 minutes after the hour all across the state of Michigan. There's a soldier from Grand Rapids who is going to be the special guest of the First Lady at tonight's State of the Union address. It's Staff Sergeant Brian Mast. He is going to sit with Michelle Obama during the President's annual speech to Congress. Mast lost both legs and a finger in a roadside bomb blast in Afghanistan, and he recently achieved his goal of walking on prosthetic legs, and we'll try to reach out this morning to Staff Sergeant Brian Mast, who is at Walter Reed Hospital, but tonight he will be in the Capitol building sitting right next to Michelle Obama during the President's State of the Union address, and he is from Grand Rapids. Tech sector and materials lifted stock prices yesterday. The Dow nudged closer to the 12,000 mark, climbing 109 points. The S&P gained 7 points, and the NASDAQ gained 28 points. It's 27 minutes after the hour now. Despite the woes that have afflicted both General Motors and Toyota, both companies did well last year moving product. The latest figures indicate Toyota, the world's biggest car maker, selling nearly 8.5 million vehicles, GM slightly behind the 8.4 million vehicles Toyota sold, just behind them. And there's one area, though, where America's number one automaker beats Toyota, believe it or not, that's sales in China, where they exceeded GM sales here in the U.S. So isn't that interesting? GM sold more than 2.3 million cars and trucks in China last year compared to the sales of 2 million vehicles in the United States. It's a lot of big numbers there, but what it means is good news for General Motors. Even though they didn't surpass Toyota, they're selling and building a lot of cars. Do you have a Borders gift card? Maybe you got one for Christmas? Well, you better use it because a law firm has been hired by Borders Group to protect it from being forced into bankruptcy. So dig through your pile of holiday cards and reach down to the toes of your Christmas stockings, because the reason is anyone with a Borders gift card lying around could see the value wiped out. So consumers should do themselves a favor, get to the nearest Borders and get full value from your gift card in case that company based in Ann Arbor goes bankrupt. Armando Galarraga has been traded by the Tigers. We're looking for Larry Sorensen this morning for his comment. This was the pitcher who some people say he pitched a perfect game. Because the umpire blew the call. Everybody admitted it, and Armando Galarraga handled it with great aplomb, and the umpire apologized, had a tearful apology for blowing the call, but it can't be reversed once it's made, and Armando Galarraga, who very nearly had an official perfect game against Cleveland, finished the season, though, 4-9 with a 4.49 ERA, and they've traded him now for two minor league pitching prospects, a 20-year-old and a 22-year-old. And so Galarraga goes away after nearly going into history here in Detroit. The Red Wings host New Jersey tomorrow night. That's their last game before the All-Star break. And the Pistons got a rare road win yesterday, 103-96 victory over the Magic in Orlando. The Pistons are 17-28 on the season now, and they're hosted Denver Nuggets tomorrow night at the Palace. Unfortunately, the latest USA Today top 25 college basketball poll is without Michigan State. They've dropped out after a loss to Purdue on Saturday night in West Lafayette. MSU Spartans now 4-3 in Big Ten play, and they're going to get Michigan Thursday night and East Lansing, and we are going to speak with the coach of the Michigan basketball team this week, and we'll talk with Will Thiemann, too, about that big Michigan-Michigan State game. Rich Kincaid will be guest hosting on Thursday and Friday. He'll be at the Michigan-Michigan State game, and he'll be talking to Coach Beilein there from the University of Michigan about the pomp and color of that game. Jay Cutler, the Bear quarterback, got a lot of criticism for coming out of the game. He sprained a medial collateral ligament during the NFC Championship loss to Green Bay, and the medical staff told him to sit down. It wasn't his decision to be hiding on the sidelines there, even though he got a lot of criticism and people said, was he really injured? Well, the medical staff told him to do it. It is 30 minutes after the hour right now. We're glad to be joined by the mayor of the city of Grand Rapids, George Hartwell. Thanks for being with us so early this morning.
Well, good morning. Glad to, always.
We're going to see you next week at the Grand Rapids Auto Show when we're broadcasting live from downtown there from DeVos Place. But I wanted to talk
to you. That's always a great event, isn't it?
Yeah, and I
love it when the auto show comes to Grand Rapids.
Well, there's all this great automotive news this morning and over the last month or so about General Motors and Ford and Chrysler, too, and so we'll be glad to kick the tires there at DeVos Place. One wonders, will there be any motorcycles at the auto show? I know why you're laughing, and the reason is that this concept...
I have a feeling I know where this is going.
Yeah, it's going to River City Bike Week, and the idea that we're talking, as I understand it, an estimate of $22 million to the local economy, 100,000 motorcycle riders, Steve Miller Band, ZZ Top, the Doobie Brothers, all in the first week in July. Now, for some people, that sounds like heaven. And for some people, that sounds like hell, and not Hell's Angels either, right? What do you think?
Well, the community is certainly of two minds on this event. You're right. The stats you gave are those of the promoter, and I believe they're a bit aggressive. We know that the economic impact for Art Prize that brought 250,000 people to Grand Rapids was just about $7.6 million. So 22 sounds a bit on the steep side to me. Nonetheless, there's clear economic benefit and impact for the community by having this event in Grand Rapids. On the other hand, if they're anywhere near close on their estimates of how many people would attend. 50,000 motorcycles driving around Grand Rapids is indeed for many people a nightmare vision. We've heard from many of the downtown businesses, from many of the downtown more of the upscale restaurants, concerned about the impact that it would have on their business. The hotels are scratching their heads now, trying to figure out, whether this is a blessing or a curse. But the commission will get a chance to hear from both sides today, and be interesting to see where the conversation goes.
When will the decision be made?
Well, I think before the day is out, the commission will make a decision on whether to drop a checkered flag for these. Bike Week folks, or is it the green flag? You see, I'm not a racing enthusiast. Whatever it is, we'll either decide to stop this in its tracks before it gets too far, or to let them go ahead. There's been some talk about a compromise, maybe shortening it from a full 8 days down to a long weekend. We'll see where the promoters are on that, but. I think these are the kind of events that, that can, if done well, can be of real benefit to a city.
You know, a lot of people think that bikers have this image of being ruffians, and while I'm sure some of them are, I've seen that Wild Hogs movie. Some of them are, white-collar professionals who like to get on a bike on the weekend and live out their sort of fantasy, but I can see why it would rub some people the wrong way. They say maybe it doesn't fit the image that we're going for in downtown Grand Rapids, but then again, it's an interesting dilemma, and I wish you good luck with it today, and we'll look forward to finding out whether this Bike Week is going to happen in Grand Rapids, and I'll see you next week at the Auto Show.
Thanks.
You very much to Mayor George Hartwell, who will be with us in person next week at the DeVos Place for the Grand Rapids Auto Show. 35 after the hour, Michael Patrick Shields. So will ZZ Top be coming to Grand Rapids or not? We'll find out today, apparently. This bike fest that's being planned for the city may or may not get the thumbs up from the Grand Rapids Commission. The mayor says negative reaction to the idea of 100,000 bikers bringing $22 million worth of spending to downtown Grand Rapids in the first week of July. Steve Miller Band as ZZ Top. These are already scheduled, according by the organizers of it. So we'll talk to them one way or another tomorrow. Doobie Brothers, too, would be coming in, but some people downtown are saying, I'm not so sure about that idea. George in Battle Creek is with us at 888-900-9966. What do you think, George?
Well, I think that the bikers have invited themselves to the party and Grand Rapids doesn't want to host the party.
Nice play on words there. Invite yourself to the party is the title of my recent book. And yeah, they 100,000 of them want to come down and make all that noise and move up around downtown. And the city's a little uncomfortable with that idea, but it's worked.
I think it's a certain group within the city that's uncomfortable with it. The stuff shirts, I would call them, that own the higher class restaurants and the places they feel the bikers aren't going to come and spend their money.
Uh-huh.
My personal experience with bikers, and I'm not a biker, I just hang out with a couple that have bikes. These are older gentlemen, like you say. I guess you'd call them white-collar professionals. One of them is a successful farmer, in the retirement age now. They have the disposable income to spend, and I would wager that if that group comes to town and the mayor questioned their economic impact, that he's dead wrong, and that the bikers loosen their wallets and their purse strings probably twice as much as what those art prize people walking around to look at some free art did, and they probably would have more of an impact as what's even projected.
Yeah, these are not the ruffians. These are a lot of white collar people who like to go on the weekend and put on a leather jacket and maybe some chaps. Is that what they're called? The chaps and leather chaps and be bikers, be tough guys. I saw that movie Wild Hogs. I saw how it works. Thank you, George. We'll see how it shakes out. It is 41 minutes after the hour. Daniel Stone, the senior reporter from Newsweek's Washington Bureau, covers national politics and more. And you can find him at Newsweek.com and a contributor to the political blog, The Gaggle. Daniel Stone, we're speaking about Grand Rapids, and the latest issue has a list of dying cities. And I can understand why Detroit would be on the list, and I can understand why Flint would be on the list, but Grand Rapids, really? A dying city?
Yeah, I think the term dying was a bit harsh here, but what we did was take a look strictly at population numbers that came out of the census this past year. And you're right, one of the most dramatic population declines was in Detroit with 4.2%, but Grand Rapids also had a 2.1% population drop since 2000, so over the past decade. That's pretty substantial, and it is, I think, reason for pause. A bigger reason for pause comes out of Flint, not too far, which saw a 10.8 population drop over the past decade, so much more dramatic there.
Hmm. Yeah, I guess it's the image has a lot to do with it. What the reason I'm surprised with Grand Rapids is because we hear all good, positive stories coming out of that town, while Flint and Detroit are riddled with corruption and crime.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right there. And one of the points that I think the president's going to speak about tonight and certainly in the weeks to come is about, cities in Michigan and cities certainly down in Louisiana, and talk about certain cities like Detroit and Flint and perhaps even Grand Rapids as cities in transition, and talk about focusing things like, education, infrastructure, and innovation funding to try to build up those cities and attract new people, new industries, and certainly new economic activity back to your neck of the woods.
Speaking of the president's State of the Union address, apparently U.S. Representative Michelle Bachmann, the Republican from Minnesota, who may or may not be thinking about running for president, is going to deliver her own post-speech message to conflict with Representative Ryan's official rebuttal. But I wanted to play a piece of audio from a speech that she gave, I think it was on Friday, to a group in Iowa where she talked about the history of the United States. Here's what she said.
How unique in all of the world that one nation that was the resting point from people groups all across the world. It didn't matter the color of their skin. It didn't matter their language. It didn't matter their economic status. It didn't matter whether they descended from nobility or whether they have a higher class or a lower class. It made no difference. Once you got here, we were all the same. Isn't that remarkable? It is absolutely remarkable.
It might be remarkable, Daniel Stone from Newsweek, but it's hardly true, is it?
No, it's not quite true. I mean, perhaps America, in its most perfect ideals, I suppose, that's democracy at its finest, everyone equal. But certainly in a free society with democracy and capitalism, it's a bit more nuanced than that. So, like you said, she's going to be delivering her statement tonight. Republican leaders aren't terribly pleased, but remember, after the State of the Union, usually any big speech, every member of Congress has an opinion. It's really the job of the networks here who are going to pick up her statement, and they're billing it as something big coming from the Tea Party. She feels compelled to make a grand statement, but the Republicans are saying she does not speak for the Republican Party, and they're pointing to Representative Paul Ryan, who's making the official statement.
I would say there are some Japanese and some Irish and some African-Americans who would take issue with what she just said about everybody being equal. Real quickly, in 5 seconds, Keith Olbermann leaving MSNBC. Your reaction?
Yeah, I mean, he was a firebrand, and I don't think that's the last of him. He's off TV for about 6 months. I think he'll be back in some capacity.
We will read you at Newsweek.com. Thank you to Daniel Stone, live from Washington, where the president will give his State of the Union address this very night. It's Michael Patrick Shields. It's a Grand Traverse Tuesday, sponsored by the Traverse City Convention and Visitors Bureau. You can go to traversecity.com and plan to attend one of their very special events coming up, like the Beer and Boards Festival. They're also going to have the Outdoor Hockey Classic at the Park Place Dome in Traverse City. There will be the chili cook-off in the Dome, and then you go outside and watch hockey. That's January 29th through January 30th. And if you'd like a pair of lift tickets right now, for free from us with our compliments and compliments of the Traverse City Visitors and Convention Bureau, just call 888-900-9966. You'll get lift tickets at Shanty Creek Shush Mountain. You can use them anytime you want this season. The number 888-900-9966. You can give them away, whatever you want to do. We have two lift tickets right now for Shanty Creek Shush Mountain in the Traverse City area at 888-900-9966. Kyle Malin is with us from MERS News. He's the editor there in our Gillespie Group storefront studio. Good morning to you.
Oh, shoot, Michael Patrick. I didn't have time to get on my phone and call that number.
Could have called the cell phone.
I wanted some lift tickets.
And get some lift tickets. I think we can sort that out if you want to go.
Oh, God, that'd be great. I love skiing. Love skiing.
Governor Granholm is going to be leaving this snowy state of ours, it seems, and she and her husband and family will be going to California to teach at the University of California, Berkeley. But is that a surprise to you, and what do you make of that decision?
No, it's not a surprise, because Governor Granholm is an alum of the University of California, Berkeley, and so it would seem if she was looking to expand and do something different, that would be where she would go. Also, her parents are elderly. Dad, Vic, has some health issues. So I think she wants to be closer to her family. I mean, 12 years here, four as Attorney General, 8 as Governor. She's been away from her parents. And like any daughter, her parents are getting old, so she wants to be near them. So they've got a 2-year, I guess, contract, if you will, at the University of California. Both Dan Mulhern and Governor Granholm will be teaching out there various subjects dealing with the economy and government. And Dan Mulhern will be teaching a leadership class, so he's very excited about that. Mm-hmm. They're also going to be doing a speaking circuit. Governor Granholm is going to be a regular paid panelist on Meet the Press, so I know she's excited about that. Maybe that will evolve into something more on MSNBC. You mentioned Keith Olbermann is no longer going to be there. Who knows? Maybe Governor Granholm will be the next Keith Olbermann. they're also writing a book together. So it sounds like they've got a very busy schedule.
We're going to talk with David Gregory from the host of Meet the Press on the first day that she contributes to that program. But she's no stranger to national television, did a lot of national hits, especially during the auto crisis, right?
Oh, you know what? Susan Demas from my office and I were joking yesterday about how she's been training for this for the last year and a half, 2 years. I mean, she has been in the national spotlight, more than I think any governor here in Michigan, and probably more than any governor in Michigan will either. She was on the regular talk circuits. It seemed like every week, if not every week, every 2 weeks. So she's had a lot of practice. She's very polished in the national spotlight, very comfortable in front of a camera. You could argue that was one of her strong suits in Michigan, was getting her face out there and getting Michigan out there front and center to talk about our issues and talk about the auto industry. So well prepared, I think, for that job on Meet the Press.
They've talked about looking for a lake house here in Michigan to keep the base, their home base here in the state. What's that all about?
Well, I mean, let's face it. I mean, Michigan is a great place to go in the summertime. Mm-hmm. Our lakes are beautiful. And, I don't think they want to feel like they've abandoned Michigan. Hey, look, Dan Mulhern's also got family here in Michigan, too. They've got friends here in Michigan. It's not like they don't have anyone here either. So I think they want to have a vacation home here and have some roots here. And also, you want to have a place where you can, register to vote, too. I mean, remember Bob Bowman, former state treasurer? It was rumored that he was interested in running for governor. He actually has his voter registration up north as well. So maybe the governor and Dan Mulhern want to say they're keeping their roots here, keep their voter registration cards here in Michigan, because who knows? Maybe either one of them will want to run for U.S. Senate or Congress. Who knows? Maybe they'll get an appointment to a judgeship. They want to make sure that they have a presence here, so it's important to have a place in Michigan. And if you're going to have a place in Michigan, I'd want one by the lake. I don't blame them there.
Speaking of the U.S. Senate, Saul Lanuzis, we're going to talk to later in the program about this noise that he may run for U.S. Senate against Debbie Stabenow. You'll have to beat a crowded field, it looks like, anyway, of Republicans in search of that nomination. But do you think he has a chance?
Well, I don't know if he's actually going to get in when it's all said and done. You know, this announcement that he was actually looking at it came after he lost that bid for the Republican National Committee chair. And I was just, You know, I'm wondering if he's just looking for something else now to do. You know, after he ran that bid, was not successful. You know, maybe he's just testing the waters for something else, keeping his name out there. But at the end of the day, there's a lot of people who have been rumored to be looking at that seat. Pete Hoekstra, Mike Rogers, both of whom have experience in Congress. We also have a businessman out of Southeast Michigan who's looking at it. So I think there's a lot of people who are, you know, testing the waters right now. They see the Republican wave, think that it's a good time. Maybe Debbie Stabenow is ripe for the picking. At the end of the day, I don't see Saul Anousis being the Republican nominee. I don't even know if he's going to get in the race. It's an interesting thing to kick around right now, though.
It is, and that's what they do at MERS News. They give you behind the scenes in politics. It's MIRSnews.com, and that's where Kyle Malin is the editor, and you can subscribe to that and get all the same kind of good information we get. Thank you very much for being with us this
morning. Hey, my pleasure, Michael Patrick.
Enjoy the State of the Union address. Will it go over an hour?
God, I hope not. I don't know if I can handle too much more than that.
We'll stay tuned and find out. Have full coverage tomorrow morning, too. It's Michael Patrick Shields all across Michigan on Tuesday morning.
Michael Patrick Shields is on the air.
Good morning, world.
Good morning, Michigan. A very pleasant Tuesday to you. Politics is our family business, and we have a number of elected officials this morning in our Gillespie Group storefront studio. Wayne Schmidt, the state representative from the Traverse City area, the Republican. Good morning to you. Thank you for being here in our studio. And State Representative Chuck Moss, the Republican from the Birmingham area. Good to see you, too.
Good morning. It's a nice, warm morning here. It's not 3 degrees above zero. I love it.
A real heat wave. What is it? It's 20 or something like that?
Yeah.
We'll get through it. State Representative Wayne Schmidt, I wanted to get a little bit of an update, if you could, on the fellas who sort of preceded you in this studio. Senator Alan Cropsey, who left office because he was term limited, has a new gig.
He is. He's the legislative liaison for Attorney General Bill Schuette.
Okay. He's happy with that job?
He is. I had Tribal Chairman Derek Bailey, Grand Traverse Band of Ottawa and Chippewa Indians, down as my guest last week for the State of the State by Governor Snyder. And, of course, the tribe is working closely with the state and other groups on the Asian carp issue. So Chairman Bailey wanted an update. There was Senator Cropsey. It was great.
What about Senator Allen?
He is Chief Deputy Director, I believe that's the exact title, for Veterans Affairs. Mm-hmm. And of course, he served in the Michigan National Guard and also has chaired Veterans Affairs while a senator. So it's a good
Perfect.
Mix, or a good fit for him, I should say.
And possibly Kevin Elsenheimer, the former Republican House leader?
I think, if I'm correct, today is his first day. Workers' comp area. I don't know his exact title. I see the leader around town up north there and down here in Lansing. But I think his official role should be rolled out today.
It's a Grand Traverse Tuesday brought to you by the Traverse City Convention and Visitors Bureau. State Representative Chuck Moss from Birmingham. What's on your agenda today?
Oh, budget, and more budget.
Yeah.
That's all I do. Appropriations. And actually, right now, we're just getting organized, kind of getting the groundwork and the foundations laid, because on 15th of February, Governor Snyder presents his budget. And then we all are busy. We don't come up for air until probably around June 1st, but that's going to be what we're going to be, what is probably going to take most of our
time.
That'll
be fun, huh?
Well, yeah, actually. this is stuff we've had to do. We've known we've had to do this for years. We deferred and delayed the maintenance here, and now the choices are actually kind of down to just a few, and we've got to do it. Governor has said what he wanted to do when he was elected. He got a higher vote total in my district than I did, so I think it's my job to help him out.
Do state legislators get together tonight with a giant bowl of popcorn and watch the State of the Union address?
Not me. I think I've got stuff to do. I've seen these things, and they're generally rock concerts. I remember with President Clinton, he was standing up and saying stuff that had no connection to reality that he could never accomplish, but everybody had a good time applauding for it. And, with President Obama, we'll just have to see. Good luck, but I got work to do.
Well, he went over an hour last year, if I'm not mistaken. That's a long time to sit. And I don't know how much of that is applause and how much of that is actually speaking.
Well, he has a lot of wisdom to impart to us, and I think I'll just get the Cliff Notes version.
Okay, you can listen tomorrow morning. We'll have highlights.
Excellent.
And lowlights and whatever you like. And right now, in fact, on the other end of our line is State Senator, the Michigan Senate Majority Leader, in fact, Randy Richardville, the Republican from Monroe, who will be in the well of the House tonight for the State of the Union speech. Good morning to you, Senator.
Good morning, Michael Patrick. How are you?
Good. You'll be there tonight, as I understand it. How did that come about, and what's your purpose for being there?
Well, Congresswoman Candace Miller and I go back many years when she first helped me campaigning back in the mid to late 90s, and we became pretty good friends over the years. I've watched her as she was Secretary of State, and then, of course, a very effective congresswoman in Washington. And she called me and thought that I would, as the new leader of the Senate, be interested in listening to the address firsthand. So I know she's pulling together several other congressmen from Michigan that I hopefully will have a chance to talk to. And we're going to talk about issues that relate to Michigan from Washington. And there is a connect, it's a very strong connect, and I'm hopefully going to help build some of those bridges stronger, so to speak.
Will you, like everyone else seems to, applaud the President of the United States when that big announcement is made there, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States, and the whole place gives him a rousing welcome, at least at that point, standing O? Will you do that?
Yes, I will, and I'll do that not because I believe in the same principles that he does or that I am a supporter of his politically, but he's the president of the United States that I live in, and I think it's important that we show respect to our leader, whether we agree with him philosophically, politically, or otherwise.
It is interesting, Representative Schmidt, isn't it, to watch on camera the reaction sometimes of across the aisle, you know, of opponents of the president when he's getting a big round of applause, isn't it?
I think that's one of the best parts. You saw that last week at the State of the State.
Did you?
With a few things that made it kind of interesting for Governor Snyder. I'm sure when he'd see certain parts stand up. But we have work to do, just like Chuck, but there will be a few of us over on Hayford Street that
will
be watching.
Well, I didn't get invited.
Well, Chuck, you're invited.
There you go.
Oh,
come
on, Mr. Chairman.
Now you say that.
Wait, can you smoke cigars in the House, though?
No.
Probably not.
No.
Maybe that's
a little early in the season for that.
Oh, okay.
Well, you know, I understand there's not going to be an aisle, that the Democrats and the Republicans are all going to be sitting together in Washington, that you're not going to have, you know, one side stands up and the other doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I stood up for Jennifer Granholm, you know, when she walked in, but it's funny that, you know, you see some on one side, but I understand they're all going to be together.
What do you see, speaking of Governor Granholm, what did you make of her decision to move to California with her husband and take a teaching job and work for Meet the Press?
Well, you know, no comment.
I wish her the best. Berkeley doesn't totally surprise me.
Weather's nice out there.
I was going to say it fits a little bit more with her background. It's fine. Meet the Press. I mean, she's a very articulate, smart woman, attractive. Mm-hmm. So I think from that standpoint, you know, of course, Meet the Press.
Well, Matt Millen went on ESPN. She can go on Meet the Press.
Yes.
There you go. That's
yeah.
it. We will have the good news, Senator Richardville, is that a soldier from Grand Rapids is going to be a special guest of the First Lady tonight. Staff Sergeant Brian Mast is going to sit with Michelle Obama during the speech. He lost both of his legs and a finger in September in a roadside bomb blast in Afghanistan, and he just achieved his goal of walking on prosthetic legs, so we'll be on the lookout for him tonight. In fact, he's at the Walter Reed Hospital, and we're going to reach out to him this morning and see if we can chat with him before he goes over there. While you're in the among the Washington glitterati there, I thought you might be interested, if you haven't heard this yet, to hear a little clip of U.S. Representative Michelle Bachmann, Republican from Minnesota. She gave a speech in Iowa, and I just wanted you to hear what she said and get your reaction. Here it is.
How unique in all of the world that one nation that was the resting point from people groups all across the world. It didn't matter the color of their skin. It didn't matter their language. It didn't matter their economic status. It didn't matter whether they descended from nobility or whether they have a higher class or a lower class. It made no difference. Once you got here, we were all the same. Isn't that remarkable? It is absolutely remarkable.
Senator Richardville, it might be might have been remarkable, but it's not exactly true, is it?
I didn't really follow what was remarkable. Sorry, I got caught up in her emotional argument. What is she talking about? I missed that.
Well, the fact that she says that people who came to America from other countries were all equal once they got here, And I think, don't you, Representative Moss, there would be some African-Americans, some Irish, some Japanese.
Yeah, you and me, but you know, with us Irish, it's understandable. Well, you know, you wonder, first of all, I remember President Obama talking about, I think he was a candidate, the 57 states, and we didn't, you know, hear a lot. I don't hear a lot of clips about that. I mean, why Michelle Bachmann? Why are you, last week, I remember one after the civility argument, after the Tucson shootings, you had a to the Democratic congressman comparing the Republicans to Nazis. But I don't remember hearing that all over. You know, why it's a lot of, you make a lot of speeches off the cuff, you might end up saying some pretty dumb things. No, we all know that the African Americans didn't arrive here and be treated like everyone else, and neither did us Irish, by the way, or at least us Irish Catholics. But
the NINA laws. No Irish need apply.
When my grandmother remembered those.
Really?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah.
And then the Japanese Americans who were interred during the Second World War, they might not have felt that they were treated as equals.
Yeah, but, you know, so she said that. But
anyway, she's nice flamboyant, lady. And she's talking about maybe running for president.
Yeah, well 57 states. You know 57 states.
Michael.
You
know?
Yes, Senator?
There is a tendency, or there has been a tendency, for some that get into leadership positions to recreate the past, so to speak. And, you know, our history books should be kept intact and not muddled with, so to speak, so that we know really where we came from. There are some publishers today that are changing words and rewriting books, and that, you know, we forget about those things. And I'm not going to get up on a soapbox here, but the religious convictions of those that started our country have kind of been pushed off to the side a little bit, and the roots to what made our country great sometimes have been forgotten and rewritten. So I think it's important that we don't lose sight of from where we came, even when we made mistakes along the way.
Have fun at the speech tonight, Senator Randy Richardville, the Senate Majority Leader. We were also joined by State Representative Chuck Moss and Wayne Schmidt, Moss from Birmingham and Wayne Schmidt from the Traverse City area on this Grand Traverse Tuesday. It's Michael Patrick Shields. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
25 minutes after the hour, Michael Patrick Shields, heard all across the state of Michigan. Politics is our family business. You know that by now, and you can hear us on radio stations all across the state of Michigan. The Academy Award nominations are coming up this morning, and we'll have that audio live, the coverage of the, it's the day that Hollywood wakes up early, because it's 5:30 in the morning there. It'll be around 8:30 here that we will hear that live audio as to who is nominated for the Academy Award and what movies. Saul Anuzis is with us from Coast to Coast Strategies. He's the former chair of the Michigan Republican Party, and he twice now has run for the National Republican Committee chair job, and twice just fell slightly short, and is back in Michigan now sort of pondering what he's going to do next. Everybody knows that he is a tech genius and that he is a fine communicator. Could he be a United States Senator? That's the question some people are asking this morning. Saul Anuzis, I'll ask you the question. Could you be a United States Senator?
Well, anything is possible, right?
Yes, of course it is. And the word is that you're thinking about perhaps mounting a campaign to go up against Democrat Debbie Stabenow. Is it true?
I have been talking to people in the last couple of days. I'm actually flying out to Washington later on this afternoon, and we'll be spending a couple of days there meeting with different people, including our new national chairman, to discuss that, amongst other things. So I haven't made any decisions. There's no rush at this stage of the game, but, you know, Republicans are going into their state convention this weekend, so a lot of us will have a chance to get together and talk in person, find out who else may or may not be interested, and at the same time take a look at whether this would be a viable option for me down the line.
What sort of will be the hierarchy of decision-making? Is it a matter of who else gets in the race? Is it a matter of whether you can raise enough money? What's the sort of decision-making process?
Well, I think you take a look at a number of things. Obviously, you always consider who else is going to be in the race. There are several names that are being bantied about, but nobody's really made any announcements at this stage. I think that one of them is clearly you're looking at the vulnerability of Debbie Stabenow. I mean, she's got very low approval ratings for an incumbent, which in most cases implies that a candidate is very vulnerable, therefore the race is winnable. And obviously this is an expensive endeavor in Michigan. You know, I think Mike Bouchard raised over $5 million. Many expect that this time we're going to have to get to be somewhere in the range of $8 to $10 million to be credible taking on a two-term incumbent. So that's a daunting task for a U.S. Senate candidate, and given Michigan's economy and where we're at, it's something that you really have to seriously take a look at and talk to folks about.
Is there any scenario where the party might say to you, look, we've kind of already selected our golden boy or girl there in Michigan. We're going to put all of our resources behind X. Does that happen?
Very rarely. I mean, it could happen. It's we have what's called a Rule 11, where you have to basically get a consensus of all the leadership to do that. I have not. I mean, that traditionally happens to an incumbent, not a challenger. So I think the reality right now is people are just taking a look at who's potentially out there, what they bring to the table, what kind of interests there may be in somebody's campaign. And remember, I mean, we're a good 18 months plus away, so it is very early at this stage of the game.
Yeah, but isn't it true that whoever gets in early sometimes can get themselves a leg up on the rest of the field just in name recognition? And, I mean, these presidential campaigns seem to last almost 3 years now.
Oh, there's no doubt. I mean, this is a long process. You take a look at the state of Michigan. It's a very large state. There's a lot of ground to cover. There's a lot of people to talk to, a lot of activists out there. And that's one of the reasons that, I came out early with respect to at least the exploratory stages to take a look at what's out there. You go back in history, and not unusual. I mean, Spence Abraham, who was a state chairman, ran for national chairman, came back and ran and won for the U.S. Senate back in 94. John Ashcroft did the exact same thing. He would... Missouri, ran for national chairman, went back to Missouri, won for the U.S. Senate. So it's kind of a progression that is not that unusual here in the United States and in Michigan in particular.
In your case, going from highly partisan politics to governing, what would the difference be for you if you're elected to the United States Senate?
I think the biggest difference is I have traditionally been somebody who has helped people get elected. I've behind-the-scenes type of person rather than a out-front person with respect to electoral politics. So to me, that's the largest and biggest difference. Although partisanship, for the sake of partisanship, is something that obviously I played as a state party chairman, but I think that what's important is to have somebody who's philosophically consistent and being a kind of a movement, common-sense conservative, somebody who believes in federalism and lower taxation and lower spending. I think that all those issues that I have talked about over the last years are something that would be very prevalent and important in the front side of everybody's talking points here. And we're going to have the president tonight address the country, and the Democrats are talking about how to increase spending, how to increase the debt limit, what to do next when we can't even afford to pay the bills and the entitlements and the commitments we have today. I think that there's just two different ways of looking at it. Democrats keep charging it, and the Republicans want to eventually pay for it.
Just out of curiosity, if it were Senator Levin that you had to run against, would you even be considering it?
Sure. I think that people obviously take a look at Senator Levin, who is a long-term, very respected member of the Senate, a little differently than most other politicians, but at the same time, I think that what history has shown us is that anybody is beatable. Nobody is unbeatable. Circumstances change all the time. And at some stage of the game, the people and the voters start paying attention to who represents their views and what's in their best interest. So I think that when you've got two people like Debbie Stabenow and Carl Levin, who truly are kind of out of the mainstream on the Democratic side, more the liberal members, voted for all these higher taxes and higher spending, I think you have a different perspective.
Senator Stabenow, though, admittedly, is more beatable than Senator Levin. Is that true?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think if you take a look at her favorability ratings, their latest polls had it, I think, at 37%. Any incumbent who's under 50% is obviously vulnerable. Debbie Stabenow, I think, is very vulnerable in a year that is going to be a very tough election year for the Democrats, assuming the Republicans do a good job in Washington and their principles and do the things they promised the American voters to do. I think we're going to have a very competitive race going into 2012. Obviously, the presidential year will be a big factor here. And we've got candidates running for president who I think would be very popular in Michigan, be it Mitt Romney, Rudy Giuliani, Newt Gingrich, amongst others. So that also creates some interesting political dynamics and a very interesting environment for us.
Okay, let me get a quick call here, Saul, from Byron in Potterville, ringing in at 888-900-9966. Byron, your question or call?
Good morning, Michael.
Thank you.
Yes, just a quick comment here. The gentleman said something I found interesting, that the Democrats wanted to charge it, the Republicans wanted to pay for it. What I'd like to point out is most Americans don't want to buy it to begin with. What we want is government made smaller, not just spend less on it, but make it smaller so that it's less expensive. Let's get rid of whole departments of government, starting with, say, the IRS, the Department of Interior. The list goes on, and basically that's my comment, and I'll get off and let the gentleman speak.
All right, Byron, thank you very much. Saul Lanuzis, you heard Byron there saying that he thinks the people really want smaller government to begin with, and some of the suggestions he had would be considered, I think, drastic, but there may be a Republican wind right now, but it's not going to go quite that far, is it?
Maybe not, but I think that I do think he's right in the sense that people think government has gotten out of control and that we have too much government. I think Obamacare, as an example, was a clear example of the American people kind of revolting over overreaching of government policies. So I think that you know, what he's saying is very indicative of where the American voter is today. People are concerned that government has gotten too big, trying to do too many things, costing too much. So you add that all together, and it is a function of a... by definition, if you're going to pay for your bills, you're going to have to lower and reduce the size of government, because today we are spending more money than we can afford. Nobody thinks we're under tax. So that means you are going to have to cut spending. You're going to have to cut programs. And I would argue, you know, you could start out by cutting 5% across the board, and most people wouldn't even feel it or know there's a dent in the process. Mm-hmm. And that just gives you an idea of the kinds of inefficiencies and overbloated government we have today.
All right. Thank you very much. Good luck in your decision-making and your time in Washington there. It'll be a big night if you're there tonight with the State of the Union going on and so forth, and we'll talk to you down the road.
Sounds great. Thanks for having me.
Saul Lanuzis, the former Michigan Republican Party chair with Coast to Coast Strategies, on his way to Washington, D.C. tonight. It's Michael Patrick Shields with you on a Grand Traverse Tuesday, sponsored by the Traverse City Visitors and Convention Bureau. We gave away ski passes earlier this morning to Shanty Creek and Shush Mountain in the Grand Traverse area, but you can go to traversecity.com and plan your trip. Also, if you go to michigantalknetwork.com, we're giving away a pair of Sarah McLachlan tickets, and that is at the Wharton Center in the Lansing area, and that show is on March 14th, so you've got plenty of time to plan for it, even if you want to come from somewhere else in the state. Just go to michigantalknetwork.com. And register for that. It's Michael Patrick Shields. More politics and more intrigue this morning as we continue with your Tuesday. It's very nice to meet you and very glad to have you with us. We love when people tell us something good on this program. So we have plenty of good things to tell you about this morning. And if you ever want to call us and tell us something good, if it's that your child got an A in his math class, or that your mother-in-law was named Sweetie of the Year, or that your wife baked a fantastic batch of cookies the night before, or that your husband got a promotion, please do it at 888-900-9966. Or if you want to talk about yourself and say, hey, my New Year's resolution came true and I lost 20 pounds since New Year's Day. That's something good. 888-900-9966 is the number to do that. We're going to talk with Lansing Mayor Virge Brunero a little bit later. His State of the City speech was last night, and he had some good things to tell us. President Obama tonight most assuredly will tell us something good. He'll say the State of our Union is strong, is what he'll probably say. And General Motors is adding a third shift at its Flint assembly plant. The move is expected to add 750 jobs to that facility that builds the Silverado and the pickups. So we got some good things to talk about this morning at 20 minutes before the hour. Andy Hetzel is with us from Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan, too. He's the Vice President of Corporate Communications for Blue Cross Blue Shield of Michigan, and he's got some good news, too. On the impact of health care reform, it's a complicated topic. And we welcome Andy Hetzel to the program. Good morning. We We obviously have some sort of a technical difficulty there. If you can stand by, please, we'll figure out what's going on because we're hearing lots of music and not necessarily my voice this morning. We lose the connection. Back to the many, many radio stations who are listening to us this morning across the state. We have Mount Pleasant and Petoskey and Traverse City and Hastings, Lansing, Saginaw, Grand Rapids, Muskegon, and St. Joe, Benton Harbor, all of those with us this morning. And if you're watching on Fox 47 this morning, you can hear us too. And just log on to MichiganTalkNetwork.com if you're anywhere else in the state and want to catch up with us. We have photographs there of the staff and lots of information. You can send email there and connect with us through YouTube and Facebook. And we don't have a Twitter. We tried Twitter, and maybe we'll get back to it one of these days. Later in the morning, the nominations for the Academy Awards at about 8:30 this morning will connect, and you'll be able to hear live audio of exactly who has been nominated for the Academy Awards. We'll get you a bit of sports this morning, too. While we're at it, the Pistons picked up a rare road win with a 103-96 victory over the Magic in Orlando. Detroit is 17-28 on the season, and they host the Denver Nuggets tomorrow night at the Palace. The Tigers have traded Armando Galarraga, Mr. Almost Perfect, to the Arizona Diamondbacks for two minor league pitching prospects. Galarraga had a near-perfect game in that story where he actually came one out away and got the last out, but the umpire blew the call against Cleveland. The umpire admitted it in a very tearful speech, and Armando Galarraga didn't have a fit. He didn't have a bird. He just sort of said, well, handled it like a true professional and a real sportsman. And so Armando Galarraga, though, aside from that highlight of the year, his record was only 4-9, and he had a 4.49 ERA, and so he's going away. He's been traded to the Diamondbacks for two minor league prospects, a 20-year-old right-handed pitcher and a 22-year-old left-handed pitcher. The Red Wings are going to host New Jersey tomorrow night in their last action before the NHL All-Star break. And unfortunately, the USA Today poll for college basketball is without Michigan State. They dropped out of the poll following that loss to Purdue on Saturday night in West Lafayette. The Spartans are now only 4-3 in Big Ten play, and they've got the Michigan Wolverines coming into East Lansing Thursday night. We'll talk to the University of Michigan basketball coach later this week, and Will Tiemann from the Spartan Sports Network will join us for that showdown between the Wolverines and the Spartans. There was a lot of talk about Jay Cutler, the quarterback for the Bears, why he checked himself out of the game there. Well, it turns out he suffered a sprained medial collateral ligament during the NFC Championship loss to Green Bay. The medical staff told Cutler to shut it down after he played one series in the third quarter, so that's why he was sitting on the bench. He didn't look to be in terrible pain, but a lot of people said Cutler didn't have heart. He left the game, and that he was just sort of chickening out. Apparently, according to the doctors, that is not the case. It's 45 minutes after the hour now. Michael Patrick Shields on the morning of the State of the Union address from President Obama. That is tonight. We'll have full coverage of that for you tomorrow morning. The Dow yesterday, another tell me something good, moved closer to the 12,000 mark, climbed to 109, and the S&P gained 7 and the NASDAQ gained 28. And General Motors almost beat Toyota in terms of becoming the world's biggest car maker. Again, it was very, very close, Toyota edging General Motors, but the good news is General Motors is back in the game. We never let the birthday of a beautiful woman pass without taking note. Alicia Keys is 30 today. Happy birthday, darling, to you. And Christina Aguilera will sing the national anthem at the Super Bowl game. She was born in Pittsburgh, so she'll be a Steelers fan for sure. Academy Award nominations in less than an hour with live audio from Hollywood. It's Michael Patrick Shields on Fox 47 Television. Welcome back to the program. Larry Sorensen, who pitched for seven major league teams and was the voice of the Tigers, worked for ESPN, lives in Grand Rapids now, ringing in this morning. Good morning, Larry. How are you? Larry Sorensen, can you hear me? He cannot hear me. So our technical complications continue this morning on this Tuesday morning. Maybe the lines got all frozen. Is that maybe what happened this morning? We'll check it out and see. I promise you that. But you're watching on Fox 47 right now, which is A-OK. Nice to see you here on the television in the Lansing area. The mayor is going to join us a little bit later. His State of the State speech was last night, State of the City speech, and he had it down at the Knapp's Corner, that historic building that is being renovated with a $36.4 million effort, J.W. Knapp's. And the mayor is going to have to figure out how to resolve a $15 billion shortfall. And so the mayor there backed up his State of the City speech by saying, "It's happening in Lansing." And he talked about all the projects that are changing the city's landscape. For instance, General Motors, the Grand River plant is going to be adding a line there. The renovation of the Knapp store, as I mentioned. And the spring debut of the facelifted Ottawa Power Station, the new national headquarters for the Accident Fund of America Holdings. And so the mayor says we'll continue to retool Lansing as a destination magnet for people of all ages to draw people back into the city with new housing options, improved parks, and public infrastructure. And he says that we can have a lively downtown, the creative juices can flow in Old Town, and we can recharge Rio Town into a new center of economic activity. That's what the mayor's vision is. The region's central city is once again becoming the hub of the wheel instead of the hole in the donut. And it was Newsweek magazine who mentioned dying cities in America. Then New Orleans was the number one dying city in America, losing population. And in Michigan, it was Detroit, Flint, and Grand Rapids that made that list. And so this is something the mayor's been talking about for a long time, about bringing people into the city and making it the hub of the wheel, not the hole in the donut. Tonight, the president will also be talking about the economy in his State of the Union address. As we understand, the Associated Press is reporting that to a television audience of tens of millions, Obama is going to talk about jobs. That's the issue of most importance to the public, and it's important for his hopes of a second term. War and other concerns bid for attention, but the president is going to lean heavily on the economy with far less emphasis on foreign affairs. Now, we've got a $14 trillion government debt, and the president, I suppose, will address that as well. We have a soldier from Grand Rapids who will be there tonight as the guest of Michelle Obama, Staff Sergeant Brian Mast, and we'll be watching for him tonight, and maybe he'll get a shout-out from the president as well, as he'll be sitting with the president's wife after all. The news this morning that Governor Granholm and her husband, Dan Mulhern, will be leaving the state of Michigan. They're going to the University of California at Berkeley. And they're going to be she's going to be a paid contributor to Meet the Press. David Gregory, the host of NBC's Meet the Press, will join us in the coming days to talk about Governor Granholm. They are going to keep a home base, apparently, in Michigan. They're searching for a lake home at which to do that. And Granholm is going to teach classes on energy and governing during tough times and industrial policy. And First Gentleman Dan Mulhern will teach lessons on leadership. They're also going to write a book about her experiences leading the state during the recession. And so that is finally the news about where Governor Granholm will be working now that she's no longer the governor. The Grand Rapids Commission today is going to decide, according to Mayor Hartwell, who we spoke to earlier, whether or not to have the River City Bike Week in the first week in July. It could bring $22 million to the local economy and 100,000 motorcycle riding people to Grand Rapids. The mayor told us he thought those numbers were a bit ambitious. They were presented by the organizers of the event, who have also promised the Steve Miller Band, ZZ Top, and the Doobie Brothers. But apparently the mayor's been getting a lot of feedback by email from local business owners and residents who aren't sure they want all that noise in downtown Grand Rapids. So if public sentiment, at least those who reach out to the mayor, wins, there won't be this bike festival in Grand Rapids. Good numbers for Amtrak. They're picking up lots of business on the Pierre Marquette line that connects Grand Rapids to Chicago. Also, the Wolverine line, which takes riders from Pontiac to Detroit and over to Chicago. Growing numbers of people using public transportation. General Motors adding a third shift to its Flint assembly plant. That means 750 jobs to the good, but at the same time, 400 people will lose their job in Kentwood because JCPenney is closing down its catalog call center there. They're focusing more on their internet business. The Hastings City Bank has been operating out of City Hall because of a gas leak. They'll be back in their home quarters today. If you're doing any banking in Hastings, because I know we've got listeners there, on WBCH, part of our network of stations all across the state of Michigan that join us every day here on the Michigan Talk Network. My name is Michael Patrick Shields. Television viewers, we will see you tomorrow right here on Fox 47 with coverage of the President's State of the Union Address. We'll have audio clips of the President in case you don't want to sit through the speech tonight, and full analysis, too. That's all tomorrow morning. And the question, should you sleep with your pets, will be answered definitively by a doctor and by the USA Today. Can you guess the answer? Find out with us tomorrow. It's Michael Patrick Shields here on Fox 47. Have a terrific morning, and let's talk tomorrow.